to the special presentation of The Antidote to Deception. Today on our blog talk, we're looking at New Testament sanctification. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we present this rather short study, we ask you, dear Lord, to even be in it, dear God. Let the few moments spent, Lord, just looking at this thought edify your people. May the words, dear God, that are expressed come through with clarity, dear God. May your spirit indict our hearts. May your love, may your spirit, may everything about you, dear God, come through in this message. May it be about you, dear Lord. And may your people see the importance of New Testament sanctification, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our verses under consideration today are Ephesians chapter 4, 14 to 32, Romans 12, 9 to 21. But our scripture reading is taken from John chapter 17, verses 17 and 19. And Jesus is praying, and he prays, "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." Verse 17. Verse 19, "And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth." And again, our scriptures come from Romans 12, 9 to 21, and Ephesians 4, 14 to 32. So it would be good, while you have time, to go through these passages. In the New Testament, the word sanctify and its derivatives occur many times, and never does it ask us to sanctify ourselves. Notice we just read in our verse under consideration, John 17 and 19, that Jesus says that he sanctifies himself, that those who are sanctified in him. So then, what is New Testament sanctification, and how is it relevant and applicable in the Christian's life? Remember, this month we're looking at the topic, June Moon, Mortifying Our Old Nature. First of all, what is sanctification? The word that we get for sanctification in our modern English comes to us from the Greek, and that's G38, Hagios Amos, which is to purify, to concretely purify, means holiness. Understand this, that there are three stages to the Christian's full growth: justification, sanctification, and glorification. Notice for reference, "Them he also justified," Romans 8:30. "For both he that sanctified and they who are sanctified are all of one," Hebrews 2:11. "And if children, then being heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together," Romans 8:17. But this study is dealing with the process of sanctification. Unlike justification and glorification, which are both works of a moment, in other words, in both we are changed in an instant from one stage to another. In justification, we are declared righteous. In glorification, we actually are changed in a moment from mortal to immortal stage. And those are work instantly. But in sanctification, it's a work of a lifetime. 1 Corinthians 4:16 tells us, "For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day." That's what we call the process, the daily working of the work of sanctification inside of us. And notice, again, let us be clear, sanctification isn't a work that we do. Sanctification isn't what we do, it's the work of Christ in us by his Spirit. And so, as the scripture says, rightly so, Paul, understanding biology very well, our physical makeup, even though on a daily basis, every time the sun rises and the sun sets, we get that closer to dying. But he says that our inner man, in other words, our moral character, should be renewed day by day. Again, that daily conversion experience, given our lives over to Christ anew, to mold and fashion us according to His likeness, according to His image. Yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Now, how do you attain to sanctification? Again, let us look at two terminologies. Imputed righteousness. This is justification by grace through faith, Hebrews 8 and verse 1. Righteousness is reckoned to our account. Please note, however, we are declared to be righteous legally, but morally we are still in the same condition. Understand it this way, there is no change of garment. In other words, just like when the son in the story of the prodigal son returns home, the father commands that the robe be brought out to cover his shame. And that's what happens to us in that moment. Notice, look at the scene and maybe you can get a clear understanding of this imputed righteousness that's called justification. The son comes home, he's all filthy, he's all smelly. But the father covers him with his robe, puts his robe on him, and puts his shoes on him. So outwardly, he looks like he belongs in that family. If you were to get a closer look at him, if you were to come close to him, you will see the difference. And that's where imparted righteousness comes in. But for further understanding of what we just said, look at Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. Our filthy rags are only covered, thus hiding our shame. Again, Luke 15, 22, Revelation 16, 15 for reference. Imparted righteousness. This is sanctification by faith, Acts 26, 18, through obedience to the word of truth, John 17, 17 and 19. Again, notice that it is not sanctification by works, neither is it righteousness by works. None of it is of our own reckoning. Again, the Bible says, not of works, but of grace. The thief on the cross was justified by faith in Christ, but he was sanctified by the death of Christ. 1 Corinthians 5, 17 to 19 tells us this. So what's the relevance of sanctification today? And that's what we want to look at for a little bit before we close out. We have a study that you can get on our website called Born Again and Born Again 2. It's two PDF handouts, and also you can listen to the audio version on the website, on the homepage, Born Again. And in that study, you can see the importance of the stages of growth from one area, the initial conversion, to growing up into Christ. Those of us who are alive today, again, looking at the relevance of sanctification, those of us who are alive today will have come up to a point where we will no longer only have Christ's imputed righteousness, our ties to heaven, but we will also have His imparted righteousness, our fitness for heaven. Philippians 3:9 tells us, and be found in Him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. In other words, every trace of earthliness has to be removed from us. This process of sanctification, this lifetime work of sanctification, is to remove every trace of dependence of self. Again, this month we're looking at letting go and letting God, our theme for our June moons for 2015. So it has to be all of God's work entirely. Again, Paul in Philippians says, and be found in Him, not having mine own righteousness. See again the relevance in 2015. 2015 sees us very advanced technologically. We have instant this and instant that. We have access to many forms of time-saving equipment. We can go from point A to point B relatively fast. And in such an age, it will become very easy to say, I don't need an invisible God. I don't need a God that I cannot see. But my dear friends, the Apostle Paul is telling us that when it comes to our spiritual life, there is no such thing as an instant this and an instant that. cannot get from point A to point B by might or power. He says, let us learn to depend upon God and God alone. Jeremiah 50:20 tells us, in those days and in that time, saith the Lord, the iniquity of Israel shall be sought for, and there shall be none, and the sins of Judah, and they shall not be found, for I will pardon them whom I reserve. In the last remnant of time, God will have a remnant people who he will have completely purged of every stain of moral defilement. How will he do it, you ask? Again, not by might, nor by power, but by his Spirit. He can do it all, my friends, he can, but he needs our consent to do it. He can cleanse us even today, but he needs our consent to begin the work. Will you let him? Will I let him? Again, today, God is dependent upon us to depend upon him to purify our characters. Practical application. In his final recorded prayer before the cross for his people, Jesus prayed that the Father would sanctify his followers. How? By the word. Did Jesus mean that those who read the Bible merely are automatically sanctified? No. Notice what he says in John 5:38-40. And you have not his word abided in you, for whom he has sent him, ye believe not. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me, that ye might have life. So again, as we just saw, sanctification is not in what I can do. It's the work that Christ is doing in me, through me, for me. It is altogether his work. He is the word. He is the truth that is sanctifying me. Psalms 107:20 tells us this clearly. Says, God sent his word and it heals. Those who believe this word are therefore benefited by it. Sanctification is not the work of a moment or a day. It is the work of a lifetime. This lifetime. Sanctification is the work of God in Christ, reproducing his character in his people. Note these final scriptures as we conclude. 2 Corinthians 3:16-18 tells us, nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Verse 18, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We are to be changed, my friends, from one character to another. Sanctification, then, is the work of God, whereby man's glory is laid in the dust and Christ has unobstructed reign in our hearts. So, what's the relevance, what's the importance of New Testament sanctification? Many people merge the two into a synthesis which is called infused righteousness. But my dear friends, the work of righteousness by faith, justification by faith, and sanctification by faith, even though they are inseparable, they are separate. Because even though, just like the thief on the cross, he went to his death, not having accomplished one good work after he gave his life to Christ, it was imputed to him and it was imparted to him by Christ. Notice, same thing in our account, but my dear friends, the difference is that today you and I live and move and have our being. And so Christ expects us to allow him to work out his life in us. We have to come up to a higher stage, a stage that none have ever been before. And so this closing thought, and then we pray. New Testament sanctification is the work of only one, and that is God. John 17:17. Our only cooperative role is to surrender to the inner working of the Spirit of God. James 4:7-8. until my change comes, as Job says in Job 14:14. I stand confident, and so should you, that he who began this good work in us is able to perform it. Justification is God's word that declares us righteous. Galatians 3:6. Sanctification is God's word that makes us righteous. John 15:3 and 17:17. It is God's work alone in restoring back in us his righteous character, and he alone is able to keep us from falling. Jude 24. Our only work then is to enter into this experience through belief. May this be your experience and mine. In Jesus' name, amen. Dear friend of mine, you may be listening to this presentation and you have not fully surrendered to the promise, the work that Christ is willing to do for you. You may have been a Christian all your life. You may just even now have entered into this new relationship and you have not been taught properly. You have not been told that just because you name the name of Christ, that's not it. Christianity is not a social club that you've entered into, some secret fraternity. It's a calling. It's a way of life. It means a radical transformation. You who was yesterday ought not to be anymore. Not in a moment, but day by day, there should be change. It should be evident by word and action that there's a power working in you, within you, a power from above that's transforming your life into Christ's likeness. May this be your experience, and may you learn that it is not by your efforts, not what you can do, not what you can produce, that will give you this experience, but a daily dying to self, a daily surrender to Jesus, and being willing to be molded and fashioned to be like him. Let us pray. Father in heaven, as we close out our blog talk for today, we ask you, dear Lord, to please be with every person who is listening. Lord, let your word come through with clarity. Speak to your people, dear God, and help us to see that you and you only are the source of every good word, every good thought, every good action. May we learn to lean and depend upon you, Lord Jesus. And at the end of it all, at the end of it all, Father God, we ask you to save us into your kingdom. Lord, I pause and pray now for some such soul who have not made a full surrender of themselves to you because they are afraid to trust themselves to you. I ask you, Lord Jesus, that you would please reveal your heart to them. Let them know that you love them. And God, I'm asking you in Jesus' name to please, please cover them with your love and your protection and keep them safe until they're able to make an intelligent decision for you. Bless us now, dear God, as we separate one from the other in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, I hope you can join us this week as we look at in our Antidote to Deception Internet Radio Program, part two of our series looking at segments from the book Steps of Christ. Today we're looking at chapter 2, The Sinner's Need of Christ. And as always, please visit our website for more information on these topics. You can find a handout of this study, a PDF copy, on our website and our blog page under the study section. Continue to learn of God. Continue to study more until we meet again. God bless.